Welcome, everybody. My name is Matthew Raskoff. I'm Vice Provost for Digital Education at Stanford. We are so glad that you have joined us for this book talk in our series on academic innovation for the public good. These are monthly online conversations about how to make change in higher education. And this talk is the first in part two of our series for this year, which explores how to unlock the knowledge created within universities and share it more openly with the world. You can register for our other upcoming events at the link that we will post in the chat right now. This series is co-organized by my team, Stanford Digital Education, and Trinity College, our wonderful colleagues on the East Coast. And I'm particularly grateful for all of our contributing partners who are shown on the slide here as well. If you and your institution would like to join us in making this terrific series happen, please reach out to me and we will share the details with you. We would love to have more partners, especially as we plan out the program for next year. Each event in the series features a prominent author of a recent book in conversation with a colleague. And our goal is to help translate cutting-edge ideas from research into practice via classrooms, via policies, or via new technologies. And we've already started, as I mentioned, to plan for next year's author conversation series. We've got some terrific new scholarship coming that we're going to read together. And we welcome your suggestions for books that should be included in the series in 2024. We'll post a link in the chat for that as well, and hope you will nominate books that are on your radar for next year's events. With that, I am so pleased to introduce our author, Peter Kaufman, Senior Program Officer at MIT Open Learning and founder of executive producer of Intelligent Television, the video production company and research and consulting firm that he founded. In his book, The New Enlightenment and the Fight to Free Knowledge, Peter argues that ongoing efforts to find the right balance between state, society, and private entities' control of knowledge have historical roots in the Enlightenment, and the free flow of information is crucial to our networked age. He discusses the special role that universities must play to enable more equitable sharing of knowledge and to combat the current problem of pervasive disinformation. I read this book. It was gifted to me by Peter, and I loved reading it, and especially the historical parts of it, starting with the Wycliffe Bible, which is not where most stories about open education start, but it was a fantastic opening and a total reframing of the topic for me. Peter will be in conversation today with John Willinsky, Kosla Family Professor Emeritus at Stanford Graduate School of Education and founder and co-scientific director of the Public Knowledge Project, which works to improve public access to scholarship through open source software. And I'm so glad to have a Stanford colleague here with us to enable this conversation and to meet you as well, John. And so thank you for joining us today. Really grateful for both of you for being part of this series. Before we begin, I just want to briefly outline the format for tonight's program, and then I will hand it over to John to moderate. Peter and John would love to hear what you're interested in. Please submit your questions using the Zoom Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. You can do that anytime in the event. We will gather questions, you know, as we engage, and we will move to the Q&A in the second half. We'll be using the Zoom chat feature on the right side of your screen. So if you want to engage with others who are in the room, please do that as well. We do monitor the Zoom chat for any instances of inappropriate or disruptive language, and if necessary, we'll remove users from the event. Automatically generated captions for the event are enabled, and you can see them by clicking the Show Captions button in your meeting toolbar. Then we'll provide edited captions when we make the available event recording available online. With that, John, I am happy to turn it over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Matthew. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to welcome everyone who's attending. As a way of a preface, let me just say that Peter and I know each other. This is not going to be a stilted conversation or an introduction of one to the other. We've known each other for some years and are, I can say, fans of each other's work. And this book particularly, like Matthew, I am a very enthusiastic, I have been a very enthusiastic reader of it, and I want to point to some of its most exciting elements and some of its great scholarship and a good deal of its contributions come with wit, with grace, and just a very powerful message. So Peter, let me begin with this question of history, the role that history plays in your thinking, the way in which you are motivated or inspired. You're talking about the future of knowledge here, and yet history plays such a prominent part in how you come at it. Help me understand that role of history.
Thanks, John. Let me say thank you first to Matthew, and then to you and to Stanford Digital Education and Trinity and the co-sponsors of this series. Academic Innovation for the Public Good is such a good title. And actually, I'd rather be at Stanford today, actually, but this is like virtual reality. But given that it's a conversation about the public good, I'd call it virtuous reality. So we're having this conversation here. I mean, I guess, you know, this is a book that starts talking about today, but in the early 16th century, and draws some parallels, as Matthew was saying, and as you and I have discussed, between those nutty years and these nutty years. You know, taking a big look, you know, 500 years, and then diving deep into sort of certain centuries, the century where the Enlightenment got kicked off, or the century that, you know, featured the opposite of a lot of what we're trying to talk about and further, which is the century that featured the, you know, totalitarian thought control in so many parts of Europe, like in Asia, like the it brings you somewhere, you know, it puts things in perspective. So I think history is super important. I guess to get particular about it, you know, I'm interested to know, looking at history, is there some kind of teleological principle that goes along with other detectable advances in civilization, like the wheel, the sail, you know, the boat, the bicycle, the car, the train, the plane, the rocket, that can take us somewhere, that can take us maybe even now on like an imaginary journey where we can imagine progress to a world where more and more knowledge is freely available, freely shared, and produced with freedom foremost in mind. So that arc is something that, you know, I'm super interested in, and I hope it exists.
Okay, well, thank you, Peter. Let me push you a little bit more into that, because I think your fascination with history is something that you share. But I want to be clear that you have I wouldn't say gruesome, but you have a taste for detail. You focus on very difficult moments. William Tyndale did not end well. And this kind of fascination, do you see it as motivational, or do you see it as entertaining and engaging? There's a rhetorical force to this book that I think is achieved in part by the dramatic detail. And so there's a sense in which your interest in history is driven by this, well, I want to suggest this fascination. The boyhood pirate in you or something is drawn to this. Is that a fair characterization, or are you just the objective historian?
No, I think it is. I mean, the detail about an individual who suffers, in Tyndale's case, you know, the ultimate fate of being like burned on an auto da fe at the same time that he's being strangulated, you know, that's not a good ending, as you put it. That is like those two things, you know, together. I have bad days even at MIT, but come on now. I think that the detail about an individual's fate like this can serve to like remind us what society's fate can look like on a larger level, in a wider scope. And I'm not shying away from suggesting that the consequences of some of the policies that we enact, or some of the inaction that we render into policy, you know, will have us end up in not a pretty place.
Oh, and you make that very vivid. And I think that's part of the force of the book is the way in which it engages. But I also want to be clear that you are a great reader of history, but you are also a recorder of history, that the work in Eastern Europe is particularly vivid. And I want to ask you whether that wasn't just incidental, that was a formative experience for you in terms of your understanding of what freedom around knowledge means and what our goals are with regard to that?
It definitely, you know, accidentally or not, rendered in high relief what can happen when a society is virtually destroyed by the wrong kind of policies and the wrong kind of leaders. Like Timothy Garton Ash, who chronicled all those great East European revolutions in the New York Review of Books, what Jim Billington, the Librarian of Congress at the time, called the New York Review of Each Other's Books. But the New York Review of Books, he called what happened in Central Europe and the challenges that faced all those societies after 1989, the challenge of recreating the aquarium after it had been made into fish soup. Not easy. It drew everything in stark relief for me. I started as a Sovietologist, skills that are all also useful, by the way, in the academy. We can talk about that later. But and in Central and Eastern Europe, and then the former Soviet Union, you could see what the consequences are for living in an information environment that's upside down and inside out.
Well, so jump with us into the parallels with today. Take that very direct experience you had in Eastern Europe, and the counter move in Eastern Europe as well, to circulate literature on photocopies or even more primitive systems. So where do you see the most direct parallels with the world that we're facing today, with book banning on the rise, censorship in schools and education systems, with the lack of trust around the press that we're experiencing? So what you've mentioned, Matthew mentioned disinformation, and misinformation is another aspect.
I mean, there's three aspects to it, I guess. One is that, you know, I spend a chapter in this book talking about the consolidation of media in book publishing. I address it in television and radio that existed in these countries. There was almost a blueprint for how to run a totalitarian, Orwellian, Huxley-ish system. It's unbelievable. And a number of these revolutionaries before 1917 from Russia, but other thinkers too, put some of this forward in a way that they thought could be progressive if it fell into the right hand. So there are a lot of lessons there that we have to study. But that consolidation involved then one major bookseller, only a handful of publishers, and when you study the landscape of scientific, scholarly, technical, medical publishing today, or trade book publishing, or the film industry, or the music industry, but really those first things that have to do with knowledge as opposed to entertainment, academic knowledge, academic innovation for the public good, what we should pay attention to, you see that kind of consolidation happening. So that is an issue. And then, the second thing would be, there are a lot of people who tried to express themselves and build alternative systems. Many of them did not end well, by the way, but with samizdat, self-publishing and other things. And I think there's there's some call I'm making in this book to explore, you know, whether the commons, some of the things that we treasure so much, like Wikipedia or the internet, the Internet Archive and others, might be even more essential than we imagined when they first started some 20, 25 years ago. And the third thing, I can't remember, but those are the first two.
Pick up on the question about commerce and capitalism, because I think one thing, and this would be helpful for me too, because I wrestle with this as well, as an advocate of the commons, an advocate of open access to research and literature. So where is the line in terms of the role of capitalism? You could be accused or said to vilify commerce and capitalism. And so I'm happy to draw examples for you. I think Brewster Cawley is a good example. The Internet Archive is essentially funded by the profits he made from his sale of the search engine to Amazon. And there are, I mean, MIT and Stanford are quite implicated in terms of the support of capitalism and contributions to it. So where do you draw that line? I'd even ask you about the computer in which you composed the book or whatever, but not to put you on the spot on this, but I think it's in arguing in the fight for free knowledge, you are drawing a very clear line about commerce and the commons. And but I think there has to be, I mean, Google Scholar is a good example for me, where it is a commercial entity producing a public good.
It's a great question. I mean, I think there's enormous room for both commerce and the commons. I think one has to step back, like way back, maybe not 500 years back, but you know, you could step back to the Enlightenment. You could step back to some of the areas that I know, John, you studied in your work extensively and written about, you know, the origins of copyright. There was a balance intended in those early years of copyright between commerce and ultimately the public good, that commerce was intended to facilitate creativity and expression and ingenuity. But ultimately, you know, the idea was that something would wind up in as a public good after a certain patch of time. The other day, I was driving out of Cambridge to come here in Connecticut, and you know, the radio, GBH radio, was going on about the Sumner Tunnel reopening, and this is Charles Sumner, you know, named after, right, this guy. And if you think about the conversation we're having, if they had a Zoom conversation 200 years ago about the relationship of commerce and the commons, or freedom and commerce, you know, we would be watching it today, the recording of it, and we would study, also in stark relief, the evolution of our own approaches to property. You know, owning people was okay, you know, for so many people. Like, it was like, all right, it was a norm for a lot of people, not so much Charles Sumner. They were talking about the fact that all these moving vans on September 1st get stuck in the Sumner Tunnel because there's always some guy. So they have a clock in Cambridge to actually tell you what minute of the day the first moving van gets stuck in the Sumner Tunnel. But he has a larger legacy, you know, in that he advocated for freeing people. And, you know, what is it that makes everything we create as scholars or as musicians or as artists automatically a piece of property first? I don't know. I think it's worth examining that in a little bit more detail, recognizing that we've advanced along in our sense of what is and is not property before, and maybe we need to do that again.
But there's some responsibility with taking ownership of property. There's some, in the world of intellectual property, you do talk about the public domain and you talk about the gravitational force. You do a lovely analogy with Newton and the gravitational force in copyright. But I think, we're talking about your work and we're holding you responsible. So there is, and the properties of the work, I would argue, are to be admired. The property is a nice, diverse term. The capital invested in its publication, in the book's publication, might be another kind of question. So I think our finding the balance is absolutely crucial and trying to understand where that would come. I think the Creative Commons license is a really good example of keeping the responsibility, that is the attribution, while allowing for the use and reuse and yes, derivative use, potentially. So I'm looking for your sense then of examples of that balance, as opposed to simply the vilification of capitalism.
So here's one balance, this paperback edition, 1895. to give you a sense that I'm pro commerce, but also my publisher at Seven Stories Press agreed without outside compensation. I probably shouldn't say this because it may pressure other publishers in ways that they don't find comfortable, but to allow a freely licensed CC BY, if that means things for our audience members, I'm sure it does. A CC BY edition to go out into the world at one and the same time. And, you know, there are examples in this universe we live in of things that may not be sustainable by commerce alone. The very first thing I did with funding in this field from the Mellon Foundation was to do a study in which someone said to me in an interview, there's no business plan for saving the redwoods, which is probably true. And there's no business plan, likely as not, for, you know, sustaining public parks like Central Park in New York. And Central Park in New York, I grew up in New York. I'm a native New Yorker. A lot of people in Cambridge and Boston, it's tough for me, okay? So, in New York, Central Park exists as a daily reminder of the fact that if you put this public philosophy or the public good first and foremost, that is maybe the most valuable real estate in the world. I forget how many acres it is that Frederick Law Olmsted, you know, got to design. But we've kept it that way since that day by some collective will. You know, it has not, apart from a brief moment when Tavern on the Green, you know, in the center of it got busy, but it has not been, and there are numerous other examples in this world of our society's sense of balance expressed in public works like that. And the question is, in the academy, you know, what is the balance? Has the balance been achieved to everyone's satisfaction, to your satisfaction, mine? Mine's less important than yours, by the way, because you're, but also to, you know, to the satisfaction of the people on this call.
I was going to jump into Wikipedia as an example of that balance. And I was going to contrast the dependence of Wikipedia on professional authors, on journalists, on sources, and to see, again, if there could be a reconciliation, if you could take a more, the book itself is strident in this regard. And I think it's strident with wit and grace, don't get me wrong. But it is, and it does champion Wikipedia in a way that I think is entirely to your credit, because the efforts that go into it are, the whole world benefits from that. So it does call for that acknowledgement that there is an element of volunteerism, an element of dedication to the commons, but there's a dependency as well.
I love Wikipedia. Is it incumbent upon those of us who produce knowledge to produce sometimes or all the time or somewhere in between, something other than none of the time, knowledge that is directly able to drop like a Newtonian apple immediately into the commons? I would say yes. I would say that if we are shooting video of courses, and this is my personal view, because I get in trouble not only for being a native New Yorker, but also for having sometimes, these extreme, I would say yes, when we're, writing books, or when DVDs first came out, if anybody's old enough to remember that on this call, people were producing extra content all of a sudden, grumbling for the DVD edition of the film or television series or whatever. And then the web came along, and people were like, I guess. And the question is should we be attending to this call? Is there a mandate? And I would say now more than ever, because so many people are trying, in the words of Steve Bannon in another book that I'm trying to write, to flood the zone with bullshit. And the alternatives, you can leap that out in the report. The alternatives are, on our shoulders. Who else if not us, kind of thing.
But wait, Peter, we don't want to, the fight against misinformation is not a matter, I don't think, at least of the commons. I think it's on multiple fronts, including professional journalism and including the commerce, if you like, of book publishing. So I think that, I think there is a place, and maybe it's more like charity, that everyone should have an element of charity in their lives when they're contributing to the commons. Go ahead.
No, I would agree with you, as always. I would say that, the way the web is structured today, and the way Google in particular, the search engine that rules our lives, is structured, is such that when you search for something, the results that come up are generally speaking results that have been favored by knowledge institutions or and it's also the case that Wikipedia results usually land first, right? If I search for a proper noun, anything, it would seem Wikipedia pops up there first, the way things are today. And we need to make sure, if that's the case, that search results that get delivered to our children and to ourselves have within them material that is accurate, that could be a function of personal charity, that could be a function of you and me, to white men, which is a problem that we need to also unpack in terms of Wikipedia and probably other things too, but but more importantly, could knowledge institutions commit to contributing to the commons in ways that allow that knowledge to surface, to rise to the surface in search and elsewhere.
So you've done that at MIT. You've been a leader in this field with open courseware and with MIT's other initiatives. Do you find the institution, is it a given that this is going ahead in terms of the sharing, or is there a struggle? I know at Stanford, we passed an open access policy, but only 3 years ago, compared to MIT and Harvard that did it 15 years ago. So we can't expect the institutions to be there in this regard, and it's part of a struggle and a mission. And I imagine that part of your work and this part of what this book reflects is a sense of that mission and importance.
Stanford is better weather So you have that, even if you're behind on it. But, you know, in terms of like the sharing is unbelievable in the sense that MIT OpenCourseWare is one of the greatest things that has ever come about. And it continues to get revised and enhanced in extraordinary ways. Can I read like a few lines of something that Charles Vest, the president of MIT at the time, wrote? This is in this book.
As part of the infomercial? Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, that's right. I should probably, yeah, and have like a Chiron if the folks in Trinity could figure out how to put like an 800 number rolling across the... MIT's former president, Charles Vest, wrote about, at the time, a transcendent, okay, first word, a transcendent, accessible, empowering, dynamic, communally constructed framework of open materials and platforms on which much of higher education worldwide can be constructed or enhanced, the meta-university, which will enable, not replace, residential campuses. It will bring cost efficiencies to institutions. It will be adaptive, not prescriptive. It will serve teachers and learners in both structured and informal contexts. It will speed the propagation of high quality education and scholarship. It will build bridges across cultures and political boundaries. It will be particularly important to the developing world. Have we gotten there? No, we haven't. What's particularly important to the developing world is sci-hub. Mm-hmm. That's what's particularly important to the developing world, because notwithstanding the efforts that we've made in everything, which has been extraordinary from where we were, there remains much to be done. And much of that remains to be done, I think, has to do with thinking about the commons in with a closer attention to the detail about what licenses serve the commons and how information in 2023, 2024 can be shared as differently than in 2001.
Well, let me pursue that in a different way, a slight another angle, and that is the role of video. Hmm. So you are, for someone who writes, again, with such charm, you are an advocate of video. And a champion, in fact, of the motion picture, the moving picture, and knowledge. And I would want to draw the connection with the fizzing out of the MOOCs, of an example where there was such promise for the openness, not just open courseware, but open course. And to me, that it's tied to the limits of for knowledge of video, of film. And I want to give you a chance to kind of do a defense or to talk about your faith and understanding in the power of film, which I'm all for in terms of film, but as a medium of knowledge transfer, of a medium of knowledge sharing in particular.
Am I already on the defensive? That's tough. But I can say this. January 6th, remember that? So we had this attack on the Capitol, and it turns out that the January 6th committee that got together to investigate all this stuff, whatever your politics might be, it's an indisputable fact that this committee had to deal with 22 million pieces of evidence. Okay, that's the number of things that these guys... And in my view, people like Jamie Raskin and others, just heroic, the chair of that committee, unbelievable work, the cops who defended us. So much of that was video. So much of that was video records that got shown, edited, by the way, masterfully, like the great video editors whom I can tick off and whom I name in a new thing, have nothing on the editing ability of that January 6th committee. I'm still trying to track down who is in charge of those audiovisual presentations that millions of Americans watch around the world, right? How will historians in the future be able to tell the world, what happened that day, without recourse to those primary sources? And in fact, are the historians of the future likely to be telling that history in text, in print, or in a environment much like the one we're in right now, this virtuous reality where, you know, we could then click on a clip and show people? How do we make sure, as other people at Stanford are doing, I'm going to be out there soon, folks at Stanford supported, if I can plug one foundation, there are a million that are worth plugging, I should say, and I should stop and probably unscroll, you know, but if I could plug one foundation, this Filecoin Foundation for the decentralized web, they're supporting the work of the Shoah Visual History Foundation. I think there are 52,000 Holocaust testimonies that Spielberg and others have recorded from survivors of the Holocaust. Mm-hmm. And there are people out there denying the Holocaust. There are people out there doctoring those videos in many ways, creating deep fakes. How do we make sure that in the same way that you're so attentive to the apparatus of verification in scholarly publishing and what I devote a chapter to talking about in this book, how do we make sure that video can be defended and certified and in similar ways? That's a challenge that we have to really get behind now. And so Starling Lab at Stanford is doing extraordinary work in this area with Filecoin support. All of the libraries at Stanford. In general, California is way ahead of us.
So let me, that's very good. And I think those points are important to make. And I would only pick up on the notion of it as source, that the terrible events, the terrible threat to democracy that was raised on January 6th, the immense amount of video, and I think actually what the New York Times did with it was equally brilliant, but that was a source of understanding. The actual knowledge comes in the analysis for me, comes in the way in which people make sense of it and give us, that was chaos in front of the Capitol, and we need sense-making behind it. So that's kind of my check on this aspect of knowledge, but I'm interested, and I appreciate the work that you've done and the idea of an intelligent net television group that you're involved in, I think is promising. And maybe if we had been raised with intelligent television, we wouldn't be so skeptical, or I wouldn't be so skeptical today with regard to its powers. But so with intelligent television, tell me how you're moving in that direction. And I want to call knowledge into question in a moment, but let me just go one more with this one. Well, your work in intelligent television.
I mean,
the oxymoron that it is.
Now. Like, it was a name that was good at the time, maybe. I focus my work now pretty much on writing and producing some stuff where I can, but on MIT Open Learning. Intelligent television gave me a background in understanding, you know, to your point, like the dearth of, if you watch television, apart from some great U.S. Open matches that are going on right now, it's very hard to find things that are of the kind of quality, perhaps, that the participants in this conversation would look to in a library or a bookstore. And there's no reason for that, really, because there is so much quality that can be produced for television. WGBH in Cambridge it is one of the most extraordinary, you know, some of the greatest intellectual property in the world, if we're going to use that term, has been created for television. These 14-hour documentaries on the civil rights movement, incredible films about everything, mm-hmm. Cosmos, Emmett Till, music. So, yeah, I think there needs to be a little bit more attention to this universe of video now, because that's the way so many people get their information. It's through the moving image. We're going to be these books. Please, everyone, buy this book now while it's still available before publishers completely collapse.
Okay, by all means. Let me pick up just a couple more points, then we'll turn to some questions from the audience. One is your investment in knowledge, which I'm all with you on that. But the question of learning, I think in San Francisco here, one of the things that kind of struck me in passing the Jewish Community Center was, this was written an inscription, who is wise, one who learns from all people.
Yes.
And the emphasis on learning rather than knowledge. And that question of knowledge is part of the controversy that it's given, it's certified to be knowledge. And who is able to contribute to knowledge has been an open question in this country since its founding. And the right to learn has also been a source of great controversy. So your choice and the kind of reification of knowledge, that is making it into something solid and given, mm-hmm. versus a more open sense of open learning.
It's a great, can I riff off that?
Yes, please, right. We can jam.
It's a great question. And part of the next 20 years, perhaps, of open courseware involves, as I understand some of the things that we're working on now, involves looking at open courseware as an interactive environment. You know, right now, what do they call it? Sage on the stage or whatever, you know, like it's a person in front of a black, the final lecture that Gil Strang gave, MIT's mathematics professor on linear algebra, I'm sure you're gonna watch that, has over 1 million views, and we posted it just a few weeks ago. Those are extraordinary things, but you should see the dynamism in the chat. Is chat on YouTube really the only way that we can have an interest? I don't think so. I'm writing a book for the MIT Press. I've turned it in. It's past peer review. It's on video. And it includes like a profile of the very first video ever posted on YouTube. And I've talked to the guy who shot it when YouTube first started in 2006, I think it was, at a zoo in San Diego. It has 11 million comments. Like, there are people who want to engage. Now, some of those comments are goofy. But, you know, some of them are deep and wonderful. And how do you create an interactive environment where the world can participate in this learning that you speak of, where we can learn from the world? I will say that when I was at, yeah, no, it's the great professors are thinking about this.
Okay, well then, what could you take us to, just looking at some of the questions here, the question of AI, touch on it, and it would be hard to keep current in a book on the developments happening so quickly. You talked about video detection, the fake, deep fakes, and areas like that. Do you see, again, a mixed bag, or what would be the hopeful course for generative AI going forward in terms of the fight for free knowledge and the new enlightenment?
Well, echoing, you know, the perspective that you're bringing into this conversation, I'd rather hear your views on it than I'd welcome your views on it rather than expounding myself. But if you pressured me, I'd say one aspect that's super important to respect is the need, given the ability of machines to generate content that are virtual facsimiles in the look and feel of some of the content professionals can publish, or people without an axe to grind or knowledge institutions can publish, is to make sure that the content we do publish is certified and verifiable such that it's clear that when something comes out as a Columbia University course, or as a Yale course, or as an MIT course, as a University of Colorado course, like, it is clear that it is that course and not some, you know, Canal Street knockoff, where the you know, someone who might be talking about how it essentially is to change our policies given climate change can be made to say by a machine that climate change is a hoax. It's really important to figure out that verification strategy, that apparatus for the future of scholarly publishing online.
Okay, let me keep going with these questions. This, an anonymous and anonymity is an important aspect of this whole aspect of contributing to knowledge and being able to remain anonymous. Ask, how do we help ensure that our knowledge commons is representative across the diverse human experience without asking too much from those that are already disadvantaged? What about the equity aspects of this fight for free knowledge?
I kneel before that question. I think that's essential to figure out. I don't know quite how to do it. Because I don't know how to do it doesn't mean, hopefully it doesn't mean I'm an idiot. Hopefully it doesn't mean that I'm in some way, you know, biased against those people whom we're discussing right now in terms of economic disadvantage or geographic disadvantage or technology disadvantage. I don't know, but I recognize that question as essential. I think it's one of the key questions of our time. And if I were czar of all the Russias, you know, I'd take a look at the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. I think there's 16 or 17 of them, and I'd add one or two more around these areas of information and the rest of the world. Worth another conversation, perhaps. I don't know. Super important.
Okay, these questions are covering a lot of territory. One wants to come back to Central Park, the most highly funded park per acre in the U.S. thanks to private sponsorship. Also makes reference to the amount of money contributed by people who live close by. And challenges the notion of, is this really a public good? And maybe this gets back to that balance, or better, an example of private efforts being channeled in the right direction. Would you suggest that that's part of what it exemplifies?
I mean, it exemplifies a lot. I saw another question go related to the park that you know, acknowledged the fact that it destroyed entire New York communities in order that the park be built. It's a complex story. There's no question about it. Today, I look at it as an example of a public good that is somehow sustained in public-private partnerships, and that has never, in my lifetime anyway, I don't know, I don't think I've lived, yeah, but in my lifetime anyway, which is long, you know, it's always been there. And it's been there. The extraordinary thing to me about the park is that it's still there. You know, given the value that exists, and given, like, if you, for example, if you take a look at television and you look at what was the Discovery Channel or the Learning Channel, if anybody remembers these things, or what was the promise of public broadcasting, which I write about in the book, in the 1960s, and you look at what it's become, those things in particular, cable, etc. The pressures of capital, reverting to an earlier question and the dynamic that you were unfurling earlier, like, has propelled the Learning Channel into TLC, and now these are half-hour shows about tattoo parlors. One show that was called, like, 17 and Pregnant was bested by another show called 16 and Pregnant. That's the that's the trajectory that capital can sometimes take you on. It's a minor miracle that Central Park exists today, given the amount of moneyed interest that surround it physically and otherwise.
All right, let me take the broad question. We're just coming to the top of the hour here. And this is the question that maybe divides us as well here, if I can say that.
What?
Not that too many things do, I know. But this question of the project versus the manifesto. You cite manifestos, a great number. Richard Stallman gets an appendix, and Tim Berners-Lee, Wikipedia, Mr. Colley, Aaron Schwartz, Diderot's Encyclopedia. Marx and Engels, Taylor and Weaver, even on Enlightenment via television, all these manifestos in your book forms a kind of manifesto. And one of the questioners asks about how do we convince people who are hooked on entertainment and distraction to come around to reality and truth. And the manifesto is like the New York Review of each other's books. It can be insular. Versus the kind of project work where you have a specific project, where you want to bring an aspect of knowledge to Central Park, where you want to build a library, or you want to free research, or you want to make it open courses instead of open courseware at MIT. What about this argument of in terms of how we live, the pull of manifestos versus the attraction of projects?
I think it's a great... It's a great question. A manifesto is only so good, you know. You have to actually then, what is it? The challenge is not to interpret the world, someone said that, but to create it or
change it. Yeah, that's Marx. Right?
That guy. I didn't know he'd come up today, but you brought him up, not me. You mentioned. I think there's a necessary balance between manifesto, project, and somewhere in there is education. Somewhere in there is tool building, such that everybody has access to these tools. In a way, it's amazing what the mobile phone, cell phone revolution has accomplished by putting in effect a camera and a speaker in everybody's pocket. It remains to be seen worldwide. By the way, it remains to be seen where that'll take us. I agree. And I mean, if I can pull like what should be like the Zoom version of a Greco-Roman wrestling turn, I can say that the books that I have of yours that are here, you didn't know this was coming. Are history books in many ways, but then they're coupled with a recent a plan of action. I think you embody that complementarity in your work, and we should only be so lucky as to all have some of both those aspects in what we accomplish.
Well, that's very kind of you. Let's take that copyright as an issue. That you just held up, and because I think it's not that we have different views on it, but it is my project at this moment, mm-hmm. The Broken Promise and something we can repair for research publications. Your sense of it, you eyes on the prize. You do such a touching job on what copyright has done to producing such an important documentary about the civil rights movement. I mean. Tears welled up, and we were reading about rights and permissions. A credit to your writing. But what do you see then for copyright in the years ahead? I think it's one place where knowledge and learning and intellectual property is part of jurisprudence, part of the legal structure and the legislative aspects of our lives.
I mean, in the case of Eyes on the Prize, film is still such an early medium, right? Like that's the point of this new thing I've turned in, you know, what is it? Gutenberg, you know, 1450s, the Lumiere brothers, 1890s. So print has had a 400 and 40-year head start on the moving image. And already the moving image, now 130 years old, I guess, is stumbling down the same messed up, I know this is a family show, messed up path at print.
Muck, you do muck, go on, mucked up, but you do, you, yes. Mucked but up. You...
Right, so, you know, in the case of Eyes on the Prize, those videos in VHS form and then DVD form were actually pulled off library shelves because rights, underlying rights, had expired. If you look at Maria Bustillos's article in the current issue of The Nation, she writes about the fact that the same thing is happening with the way publishers are treating electronic books now, where they can disappear. And I've had experience of that. I think we need to make sure we find a world, you know, all of this is in flux. There's nothing fixed. Wikipedia is the most sort of primary example of a knowledge enterprise that's completely on the move every day, with edits being made. Probably 1,000 edits were made during this conversation. We have, seriously, like
on your entry.
Yeah, that's right. And on yours. But you know, what is the balance between all those objectives that we outlined at the very beginning of this hour? I think we have far to go to figure that out. But my hope is that in video and in copyright around the moving image, we can exert an influence that reflects our learning from the print experience as opposed to duplicating it.
Okay, that's a very good note. We need to wrap this up. Peter, I want to give you a chance to say, I certainly would join you in the thanks to the group, to Trinity and Stanford, in terms of this this whole webinar series. I think your book encapsulates as much as any book could the spirit of this series, in terms of advancing the public good. So to me, it's been an honor and a pleasure to be a part of this. And I thank my colleagues at Stanford. And Peter, I'll give you a chance to close it out.
I will just echo the thank you that you've issued now. And I'm also grateful to everybody who, you know, took time out of an early September day to join us. My condolences to you all for, you know, having to spend this tortured hour with us. But I hope that the conversation continues somehow. I know it's happening at Stanford Digital Education, and it's one of the most exciting series that that's out there. So thank you for letting me be a part of it. And no good deed goes unpunished, so I'll figure out some way of getting back at you, Matthew, for the invitation.
And thank you so much, John and Peter, for the fantastic and delightful conversation. It was just so charming to be able to listen in on the two of you going back and forth and trying to keep up with the pace of ideas and links that you were producing for us on the side. So we'll have to try to reproduce that on YouTube as well, where I'm sure this will have a great afterlife. For those who are interested in purchasing a copy of The New Enlightenment and the Fight to Free Knowledge or any of the other books in the series, we've set up a list at bookshop.org, which we encourage you to check out. We'll put that link in the chat as well. We'd love your thoughts about this event and the whole series, and we've got a survey of our users that we'll put in the chat too. Please join us there. Fill out the survey. And then we've got another great event coming October 11th with author Tamsin Peach, who will be discussing her book, The Floating University, Experience, Empire, and the Politics of Knowledge. It is the early 20th century precedent for study abroad programs and semester at sea, which people don't know is founded in the 1920s, not in the 2020s. So we'll have a great conversation with her, with Eve Duffy, who is Associate Vice Provost for Global Affairs at Duke University, my former colleague and friend there. Thank you all for attending today and for your interest in this topic and for this terrific conversation Peter and John, really grateful for both of you for being part of this. And with that, we will close. Have a good afternoon, everybody.